you go, friends. High production value intro. There we go. Got some graphics, right? It's Axe Arena time for the Deadly Cook Axes, and it would do us all well after this long series, 12 episodes. Definitely nerdy niche overkill for sure. But hey, there's some Axe fans out there. You guys been watching this whole thing, right? Right? Fly your Axe flag proud. Fly your flag proud, Axe friends. This is fun stuff. So basically, let's review about all the way back to episode one of what Dudley Cook in the Axe Book, The Science and Lore of the Woodcutter, right? A great book, a beautiful book. It's actually had a big impact on, I think, Axe culture, quote unquote. All right, whatever that is. A lot of wisdom, a lot of lore, and a lot of strong opinions about how axes should be, okay? And the core concept that we've been working on this whole time is the efficient axe, okay? Now, if you remember all the way back from episode one, how that is a different way of looking at what makes a great axe than probably what most of us personally would, all right? And it's just our use and what we use axes for is probably significantly different from professional use, okay? And he made this argument that certain axes are probably more efficient than other ones. But you could also read his whole book as an extended argument that, you know, axe design worldwide peaked in the American colonial period, and it's been a long, slow, sad decline ever since. You know, forget anything they came up with, forget the double bit axe, you know, forget the fancy patterns, forget the European stuff, blah, 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 you know? But we'll put it all somewhat to a test today in a little Axe Arena here. And let's review what our four Dudley Cook axes are and what we're looking at, really. You know, what are his arguments and what is he saying is this is efficient, it'll be a great axe. And so we'll go check them all out. All right, so we got kind of, you know, Sweden versus the United States, right? We got two Swedish axes and two American axes, okay? Both Holzbrook. One we modified, right? Swedish Disco, lower left. You can see it right there. What makes a Dudley Cook axe? Okay, what is the efficient axe? Well, you can see here, I put all the alignments out there, the center bit alignment. For curved axes, the rule is you put that thing on a table, right? And the bit hits right in the center. That also turned out to be true for the Holzbrook American Felling Axe, just as a production axe. Like, that actually works out, and it's a straight handle. Sort of an oddity, but it falls within the theory here. So we threw it in. All right, so we got a curved Holzbrook. We got a straight handled Holzbrook. They're both center aligned. They're both Montreal patterns. There's a lot of similarities there. So up at the top half there, there are American axes. And on the right, we have a viewer submission. This is incredible. So one of our viewers, Daryl Gruitt, okay, in North Carolina. I'm giving him a shout out, and he absolutely deserves this. Wait till you see this thing perform. Okay, so he just, you know, had this axe that met all the criteria, and he sent it to me. Like, you got to try this out. Now that, I like that a lot. So what it is, it's a council tool head. It's an old council tool head, but it's been modified a lot. You see that pattern there? That's cut, right? You had to cut that. That's not how it came, all right? And that's a custom carved handle. It's a hand-carved handle, I think it's a hand-carved handle, but it's really nice. All brought together into the right weight, right alignment, and the right length. So he sent it out to put it in here into the Axe Arena. And I'm very grateful. I'm really excited to take this out. And then the main wedge has kind of been the star. Oh my God, main wedge killed it in the beauty contest over on Instagram. I put all of them up. I put Swedish Disco up. I put main wedge up. And main wedge crushed it. Pure charisma in that wedge. No love for my electric blue paint job on the old Holzbrook, man. That's some glam. Well, one having it, right? Old wedgy, old pitted black wedgy thing. That is what the people love. I showed it to my wife. She goes, that's not an axe, that's a club. Where's the lie? Honestly, I kind of laughed. It's like, yeah, it's got a real club-like look to it. But this one is the purest of Cook's kind of theories of what he thought was the best. And in his illustrations, his axe is just like this, that he uses as, you know, this is the efficient axe. So it's probably the purest of the Cook axes. Clubber Mane is going out there, and I really hope my hafting solution survives actual hard use, right? That's gonna be a test, right? Could blow up, 10 swings. That'll be embarrassing. All that work we did in. But the real concern is that none of this matters if the guy swinging the axe can't chop wood. And that is very much a debatable hypothesis throughout my whole video library. I got a long ways to go on technique, and I hearken back to those old timers. I got a long ways to go because look at this guy. Look at this guy. Look at the fluidity. Look at the ease of motion. He's a lefty, I think. That's a big ass cut. He's got a little flick at the end of each stroke. So believe it or not, there was a time when I was actually a professional athlete. I actually was. That was my job. I was a professional road bike racer. It seems like 500 years ago, honestly. But I raced against Lance Armstrong, Levi Leipheimer, Christian Vandeveld, guys who won Tours of France. You know, they kicked my ass. They would not remember me. Oh, no, not at all. No, I was a nobody on a Division III team. But at least, like, I could remember that experience of being very good at some kind of physical skill. Like, you were really good, and it was your job. And it's a whole nother level of detail. It's a whole nother level of attention to detail. It's a whole nother level of pride and experience. And there's just no substitute for thousands and thousands of hours of practice. And so as I go out today to swing these axes, I'm really gonna be focused on is smooth, accurate tempo. Finding a tempo and a swing that's sustainable, you know, and that, you know, everything's about accuracy, okay? It's not about just raw power, hitting it as hard as I can. No, this is more like, you know, running a 10K than a 100-meter dash, all right? That'll be my focus, okay? And hopefully I'll get better through this process. Finally, just out in the woods, right? Early morning spring. Unfortunately, I had to cross water. I'm soaked to my knees, all right? So in order to avoid trench foot, you know, it's a real danger, trench foot. I'm gonna squeeze my socks out. Aight.
Men walking along the railroad tracks, going someplace and there's no going back. Highway patrol choppers coming up over the ridge. Hot soup on a campfire in the bridge. Shelter line stretching around the corner. Welcome to the new world order. Sleeping in the car in the southwest. No home, no job, no peace, no rest. Well, the highway is alive tonight. But nobody's kidding nobody about where it goes. I'm sitting down here in the campfire light, searching for the ghost of time travel. Prayer book out of his sleeping bag. Preacher lights up a button and takes a drag. Waiting for when the last shall be first and the first shall be last. In a cardboard box near the underpass. Got a one-way ticket to the promised land. You got a hole in your belly and a gun in your hand. Sleeping on a pillow of solid rock. Bathing in the city aqueduct. The highway is alive tonight. Where it's headed, everybody knows. I'm sitting down here in the campfire light. Waiting on the ghost of time travel.
So, even now, just with two cuts, really see how much I would have to
My fitness would have to go way up, but I would really have to pace myself quite deliberately, you know, to chop all day. You just gotta be disciplined almost in that way to stay in whatever comfort zone you got to get that far. So keep working on my accuracy. Hopefully do more of these this summer, you know, by the end of the summer, maybe I'll be chopping like, you know, Axeman food.
Against the blood and hatred in the air. Look for me, Mom, I'll be there. There's somebody fighting for a place to stay, a decent job or a helping hand. Maybe somebody struggling to be free. Look in the eyes, Mom, you'll see me. Highway is alive tonight, but nobody's kidding nobody about where it goes. I'm sitting down here in the campfire light with the ghost of old time Joe.
Oh man, imagine doing this all day, every day. Woo!
Well, after a couple hours, I can say some confidence, efficiency is a big deal, right? If you're chopping over the long haul, hour after hour, day after day, whole new techniques and skill are needed. All right, to do that well without getting sore and tired and just overwhelmed. Well, I'm not overwhelming. I'm just weak-ass octopus swinger. That's just all it is, right? But I'm getting better. I really am getting better. So there's some great channels on YouTube. You know, we should all do shout-outs to the things that we think are really great. I've learned a lot from Ben Scott. You know, he's got a small channel like mine, okay, but really into axes. He's doing a great job on the axemanship side of it, how to chop, things like that. I really deployed many of the things I had watched in his videos. Truly, I did. All right, and the notching, you know, and my swing and being aware of it and things like that really helped me out. And even today, if you were to look at our rings up here, you know, kind of my cuts, they are getting better. I'm getting more accurate. The more I'm out here getting used to the axes. Getting used to the axe is important, right? The faster you can get a feel for each one, kind of what it does, and they have little quirks, more efficient you can be.
It's finally looking better, right? Now it's getting scuffed. It's finally looking like a real axe. Great axe, very pleased, good alignment. We got it upright. I really think these secondary bevels that we got on the Holtz Brook today were sticky. They were sticky in this wet green wood relative to the other ones. All right, a big point, you know, in the idea of efficiency. Oh, look at that. Look at that. Look at that. Main wedge under stress. Probably been chopping quite a while with that guy. Woo! I was all worried about, you know, our newfangled system here, right? All our glues and wedges and dowels and such. You know what? That's a sign of success.
Main wedge be like, safety dowel be like. Main wedge, safety dowel.
Daryl, my man, this thing's a killer. Straight up killer. Very, very well done. Top of the thigh. Top of the thigh. Oh, man, I'm feeling so ranger. Hurrah!
All right, back at the Axe Studio for some closing thoughts about what I thought about that experience, what I learned. Let's just go through each of the attributes that Cook argues for in his book, okay? And, you know, did it play out the way he said it would? Center alignment, you know, the bit hitting right there in the center point, okay? Laid on a flat plane. I probably got to chop a lot more and be a lot better to experience the benefits of that effect. It seems like a really legitimate concept, right? That you deliver maximum force at the center of the bit. That seems like a good idea, all right? But in real chopping experience for an amateur like myself, I probably don't experience the benefits from that. It's such a marginal thing. It seems like one of the least of my worries, whether this bit's hitting right at the center or 1/8 or 1/4 inch off. I just, you know, more testing needed on that. Curved versus the flat bit, okay? A 1/4 inch curve up from center, a 1/2 inch curve, right? And this is far more common that you're gonna find. You don't find a lot of straight bit axes. So Cook makes the argument that you want the straight bit for two reasons. One, you get a more efficient shearing action in the cut, right? It cuts better than a curved blade. And the second argument is that it sticks less. It's easier to get out of the cut, and that's important for the efficiency. So the two Holzbrook axes were the same pattern. These are Montreal patterns, the same weight, and you know, so many similarities. After today, I think I have doubts that there's more shearing action. I have doubts about that hypothesis. But I will say that this HB Montreal was easier to get out of cuts than this HB Montreal. A lot easier, actually, okay? So with the wood we had today, it was really interesting. You know, the American felling axis, when here, it stuck a lot. It would cut really well. It would cut very deep with this 25 degree flat grind, but get stuck. Like the speed bump got stuck. And you know, so this one would get stuck too. But this one would get stuck too, and it was a lot easier to get out. It just would get stuck less. So that's a little bit of evidence that maybe it's easier to get your straight bits out of cuts than the curved bits, okay? But again, I like to try that under a lot of different conditions. That hasn't been my experience with the Holzbrook American felling axe at all in other conditions. So that was interesting. Versus straight versus curved handles, okay? Are straight handles more accurate and less susceptible to breaking? Well, the only axe that broke was the actual main wedge head. It actually cracked. My hafting solution was too strong, which I guess was good. That's, you know, you can't avoid those things, whatever. It was cool that it happened. For science, it was cool that it happened. I'm gonna watch it. So this experience today and others like in the axe arenas and stuff, my conclusion is Dudley Cook makes some valid points and they're worth considering, and straight handles are no gimmick. They're a great option. I really enjoy them, I like them a lot. And when compared with very poorly designed, cheap, you know, hardware store handles that are curved, those designs are driven by, you know, economic factors, making them as cheap as possible and finding the least common denominator that stores will accept in their inventory, right? And people will put up with. They're not great handles. But I think over time, and by time I mean decades and centuries of people using axes, there was a lot of arguments to be made that curved handles were ergonomically superior. they were a pleasure to use. They were just as accurate. They may have reduced certain kinds of fatigues and injuries. We don't know. We don't chop all day like they did. But I don't think it was entirely fashion and fad and an irrational exuberance that people just thought these were pretty. Anytime I get an axe with, you know, a hand-carved handle or a handle that's been shaped intentionally, you know, to be more ergonomic, to be comfortable and accurate, those axes are great. This was a superior handle design to all three of them and was a real pleasure to use. Does it make this axe more susceptible to breakage? Unproven at this point. Yes, the idea of an efficient axe is a good one, and it's one to consider, particularly if you're going to use that tool a lot. Because one thing I definitely learned today with these four axes is how important to efficiency the stickiness of the bit is. That's a big deal. Because the main wedge really turned out to be the least best chopper. It was the least impressive in just making nice cuts, okay? But it wouldn't stick to anything. I mean, it was a breeze to get out. You just lifted it out of the cut. And over time, all the other ones that were cutting a lot better, you know, there's a cost in time and energy of getting that axe out of the cut, and it would accumulate all day. It would accumulate over time. So Cook's idea about efficiency is a really good one. It's a professional idea. You know, you got to think about the long term, hour after hour, day after day, how much work you're doing. So you're doing more cuts maybe, but you're finding that thing out of a jam less often. But here was an axe that combined the best of both worlds. This thing cut like a champ. It was by far the best. It has a 22.5 degree full convex grind. It ate that wood up and was only a tiny bit more sticky than the main wedge. So in this case, I was not losing all that time and energy getting the axe unstuck, and I was getting the benefits of far superior angle geometry. So I think that makes an argument for those with eyes to see. There's plenty of design developments that have taken place over the last 200 years, which more than outweigh a lot of the dangers and the excesses that I think Cook was worried about. But overall, it was a fantastic experience. I learned so much. And now that the weather's improving, it's time to move on to the big axe arenas, all right? That's still out there. I still got to do those. And I have whole new perspectives on what makes a great axe. So I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope you've learned something. Thanks for tuning in. And we'll keep it up. So like and subscribe. Share this with other people who like axes, if you know any. It's a small community. But those who do probably like this, and we can all learn a lot more together. All right, so see you next time.